Hello and welcome to Marginalia, where today we're taking a look at the Argentinian author Jorge Luis Borges.
I only think of reading and of writing in terms of happiness. If you don't feel happy when you're reading or when you're writing, then, or if you don't feel greatly moved, then you're not really reading or writing.
The stories, poems, and essays of Borges deals with a plethora of great themes, all the way from books and philosophy to God, identity, mystery, and labyrinths, among others. But what holds all these works together is an almost childish joy of pure imagination and the simple happiness of writing. Now, literary analysis doesn't require biographical information. And in my opinion, the author's life or intention shouldn't interfere with the reading of a given work. However, a bit of context never hurts, so let me take you back to Argentina at the turn of the century. Borges was born in 1899 in Buenos Aires to a decidedly cultural middle-class family. He spent his youth in a large house with a vast library. He would later credit this library, which contained over 1,000 volumes, as the start of his devotion to literature. His father was a lawyer who, according to Borges himself, had literary ambitions that never really materialized. His mother was a translator, and several languages were spoken in his childhood home, marking the start to the polyglot he would eventually become. After being educated in Switzerland, he spent a decade in Europe and surrounded himself with the emerging avant-garde movements there, particularly the ones in Spain. After returning to Buenos Aires after the First World War, he brought influences from the vibrating literary landscape of Europe with him, with all its movements, modernisms, and counter-modernisms. His return to Argentina marks the period that would establish him as an up-and-coming writer, publishing poems and essays in various literary journals, such as Prisma, Proa, and Cyr. These journals are noteworthy for being of great inspiration to a later generation of Latin American writers such as Gabriel García Márquez and Mario Vargas Llosa, who are part of what's commonly called El Boom, and which brought Latin American literature to a worldwide audience, primarily through the genre of magical realism. 1939 turned out to be a fantastic and a horrible year for Borges. During a recovery from a serious head injury, and shortly after his father's death, Borges began experimenting with a new style of prose, which would eventually turn him from a locally recognized poet to an internationally renowned author. This new style resulted in a series of short prose works, somewhere between the short story and the essay when it comes to the question of genre. He called these ficciones, or simply fictions. To illustrate this new style, let's take a closer look at the short story Pierre Menard, author of the Quixote. Now, how can we understand this story? It appears to be a combined eulogy and piece of literary criticism. The narrator, or rather the fictional writer of the piece, is someone who, according to himself, was a true friend of Pierre Menard. Menard is, on the surface, a pretty minor author, but the narrator explains that there is more to Menard than meets the eye, because the most astonishing text he ever worked on, namely Don Quixote, was never finished. Well, what does that even mean? Don Quixote was finished by Miguel de Cervantes in the 17th century. But what Menard was writing, but never finished, is not a plagiarism of Cervantes' novel. It is not simply a copy. nor is it a retelling of Don Quixote in a new context. This project is another way of writing and reading entirely. The first method Menard tries is to truly become Cervantes through a kind of a method acting taken to the extreme. He has to learn the archaic Spanish, regain the Catholic faith, go to war with the Moors, and completely forget the history of Europe from the 1600s to 1918. But this method seems to Menard to be too easy, however impossible it might appear. The real masterpiece would not include this performance, but rather to stay as Pierre Menard and to write Don Quixote from that context and perspective. Menard himself explains how this mode of writing is far harder than what Cervantes had to deal with. Cervantes could use pure chance, imagination, only limited by language and his fantasy. But Menard, on the other hand, is forced to shape his creativity to the original text. In other words, the content has to fit a very narrow form. Though in this way, Menard manages to write chapter 9, 38, and a fragment of chapter 22 of Don Quixote. But to be fair, this is not primarily a text about writing, but rather about reading. The fact is, of course, that the hypothetical text that Menard produces is the exact same, word for word, as the Spanish original. The apparent difference between the two is in the perspective of the reader, which in this case is the narrator of the story. Because what we have to keep in mind is that every reader and every writer is situated in a place and time in a certain context that inevitably has implications on the interpretation of a given work. The remarkable thing about Menard and the narrator's experience of Don Quixote is the discrepancy between their position and their horizon compared to the horizon of Cervantes. With this perspective, the narrator finds Menard's version far more subtle, psychologically daring and richer. The anachronistic language and characters are not merely a comment on the genre of chivalric romance, but a way to show that a writer has endless possibilities to represent ideas that are not based in their own life. And so, in line with this perspective, the narrator begins reading parts of Don Quixote that Menard never even touched, as if though it was written by him. Again, this is simply a change of perspective, an exercise in imagination, to be able to imagine a work in a different context. And of course, this opens up the possibility of reading other works in similar ways, anachronistic and exciting experiments in reading and interpretation. And this game of interpretation and meaning is certainly a way of finding joy in reading and writing. So, are the efforts of Menard ultimately meaningless and a lost cause? Perhaps they are, seeing as, in the end of it, this is primarily an exercise in the reader's imagination. But then again, lost causes are not necessarily meaningless.